kind of quiet. Let's stand and worship together.
Coming on the clouds, kings and kingdoms will bow down, and every chain will break, his broken hearts declare his praise. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. So open up the gates, make way. God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before Him. Our God for the sins of the world, His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before Him. Who can stop the Lord?
Let's bow together and pray, shall we? Thank you, Father, for the time that we have to worship you here today, and thank you for the message of that very first song which we've sung. It's because of Jesus that we can meet here. It's because there can be joy and peace and wisdom and strength in our lives. It's because of Him that we can have the resources we need for every circumstance and everything that goes on in our lives. We come to celebrate that. We come to give thanks for that. We come to give glory to you, to ask that whatever goes on in our lives and whatever goes on today in this place, we pray that it will be for your honor and for your glory. And so we pray that you'll meet with us here in a special way to achieve whatever purposes you have for each of us and for all of us collectively. And to those ends we pray then in Jesus' name. Amen. And you may be seated, and thank you for coming today for our worship time here at Grace Bible. And if you're visiting with us for the first time, I haven't been able to scan everybody here just yet, but in case I'm overlooking anybody, we have these cards in the chair in front of you for you to fill out if you would, and to place in the basket in the back of the room so we could have a record of your visit. We'd like to know that you were here and that you'd give us a chance to contact you. On the back, there's a place for prayer requests, so if you have anything that you'd like for us to be praying about, you can write that out as well and do the same thing. Put it in the basket, and we'll join in praying with you. You know what I like about summer in Texas? Nothing. This is one of the highlights of the week. This is what I do like. We can meet together each week and worship our Lord. And as you came in, hopefully you got a bulletin. And it's got just a few things in there because a lot of things we have to cut back on during the summer because of traveling and all of that. And won't be long, we'll be back in full swing with a number of other things going on in ministries. But you can see some of the things listed right there. You can see we still have room for couples who want to sign up for Re-Engage, the marriage strengthening ministry that you can be a part of. We have 3 slots open yet. We're holding it for you. Or if you know somebody, this is not just for our church, but maybe you know somebody who would want to go perhaps through it together with you, and you could mention it to them and say, here's what it is, and take one of those flyers and give that to them and invite them to come and be a part of it as well. The meetings will start September the 10th, so be sure and give some thought to that and pray about that. You'll see men's breakfast next Saturday, so men, come and enjoy that. And another ladies' game day on the third Saturday, August the 19th. And a lot of ladies showed up last time to play games. I think 17 is what I count. Y'all didn't know I could count, did you? We have cameras around here. So I was able to look in on the kitchen area over there, and I counted 17, what I could see on the camera. But that really went really well, it sounds like. Before we resume singing, let's go to our Lord in prayer. Maybe you came here this morning, and as with all of us, you maybe have a heavy heart about something, or you know somebody who does. Or maybe you're heavy-hearted for somebody because of what they're going through. And so this is a good time for us to come together. The Lord is here in a special way. He's always, you know, around us and in our lives and so forth, but he's here in a special way when we meet together to sing praises to him and worship him. And so we're going to start here before we resume singing, just praying for those things. So bow your heads, close your eyes, nobody looking around. In fact, if you are one of those people that has one of those situations, maybe you do that by just raise your hand and say, I have a special need. Yes, okay, I see some hands. Okay, yes. Okay, let's pray, and this will be our time as we worship here today to acknowledge our Lord's presence and to lift to him that need and to give us freedom from that need so we can worship him in spirit and in truth. Father, thank you for hearing us when we pray. Thank you that you are aware of every circumstance and situation in our lives. Thank you that you want to be the resource to which we turn for every one of those things. And Father, you know our hearts, you know our needs, you know the situations in our lives and in the lives of people around us, people that we love, people that we care about, people who are struggling with hardship and decisions and whatever the case may be. But we lift together those needs to you right now and ask for you to touch lives, our lives, right now, with the reality of your presence. Let us not do what we do here today just as a routine, but as something that we do as a response to the awareness of your presence among us. And we pray you'll have your way with us today in whatever we experience and whatever you move us to decide. But we pray today, Father, that you will be honored in it all. So we pray this now and ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
That's in the blood, this future grace that's mine today, that Jesus Christ has won, so I can face tomorrow, for tomorrow's in his hands, and all I fighting a battle. You've already won. No matter what comes my way, I will overcome. Don't know what you're doing, oh, but I know what you've done. And I'm fighting a battle you've already won. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And I desperate for you. And I'm lost without you. This is the air I breathe. This is the air your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I'm desperate for you. And how deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son, the richest treasure. How great the pain of sin. until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me high. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I can't. But this I know with all my heart, Jesus has paid my ransom. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, have paid my ransom. Let me see.
Let's bow and pray as we get ready to look at God's Word. Father, thank you this morning for what you have for us from the sacred scriptures. This is your word that we hold in our hands. We pray that today we'll not merely hold it in our hands, but that from the text we study, that it will penetrate our hearts and that we'll walk away holding the truths in our hearts and in our responses. So open our eyes to all that you would have us to see today, to learn today, to have reinforced in our lives today, to turn from today. We pray that you'll have your way with us, and we'll praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. I was surprised this week at something that popped up on the internet. Way back when Ginger and I were young parents, we were like parents today, Christian parents today. We tried to protect our children from things we didn't want them to see on television or anywhere else. And We came across a television station that said, at least, that they were dedicated to protecting families. And so some of you may remember the station Nickelodeon. And it was family programming, you know, as it was advertised. And they had children's programming during the day, and then they had, in the evening, they had family programming that was wholesome and clean. And you didn't have to worry about bad language, and you didn't have to worry about sex and violence and all those kinds of things. And so way back in July the 1st, 1985, they launched their evening program schedule with all these wholesome programs, and they called it Nick at Night. Have you ever watched Nick at Night? Remember Nick at Night, some of you? Yeah, one person watched Nick at Night. Okay. You're ruining my illustration here. Okay. There we go. Now we're doing it. Now we're going. Okay. But I was surprised to find out that 38 years later, they're still saying that's what they're trying to do. Now, don't take that as an endorsement of Nickelodeon, because I haven't looked at their list of programs and so forth, so I don't know what's going on there and so forth, but it did seem pretty wholesome and so forth at the time. I just tell you that story because right from the beginning, I kind of believe that somebody on that board of directors for Nickelodeon stole that title out of the Bible. Because actually there was an original Nick at Night that is found in the Bible. The Nick was a person. His name is Nicodemus, and he came to Jesus at night for a private consultation. And so that's what we're going to be looking at today, the original Nick at Night from John chapter 3. So if you want to turn in your Bibles to John chapter 3, we're going to examine that private meeting that Nicodemus had with Jesus. We're going to find out as we look into this passage of Scripture that Nicodemus was a very religious man, very devoted to his faith, very committed to the things that he believed. But Jesus kind of upset everything that he stood for and that all of the other men who were leaders in Israel stood for. He was different. He had effect. He was the kind of person that people listened to, and of course, not only so, but there was power in his ministry as he performed miracles and did all kinds of incredible things. And so when Nicodemus could not stand it anymore, he came to see Jesus and to find out what was the secret to his ministry. So when he comes to Jesus, let's recognize right at the outset that this is a man with a need, a man with a great spiritual need. And let me go ahead and just fast forward. It won't be in today's message, but before all is said and done, and we don't know where it happened along the way, Nicodemus comes to know Jesus as his Savior. Because when we get down to chapter 19, when Jesus has been crucified and his body is going to be prepared for burial, and we read about Joseph of Arimathea taking care of those burial procedures there, Nicodemus was there as well to assist in all of those preparations and purchasing the spices and stuff that was necessary for giving Jesus a proper burial. And he wasn't there, as it's described in John's gospel, as somebody who was just an admirer, but as someone who's become a follower, someone who's become convinced of who Jesus is and why he came and why he died on that cross. Well, okay, let's take a look then this morning. We're going to be in John chapter 3 primarily, but the first thing we want to address is who is this man Nicodemus? Let's take a closer look at him and see what kind of man he was. And actually, if we want to look at this whole story of Nicodemus, we won't start in John chapter 3. We'll actually go back into John chapter 2. What often happens to us, because sometimes we don't recognize that there were no chapter and verse divisions, is we fail to take passages in their total context. But actually, the story that leads into talking about Nicodemus goes back into chapter 2 and what was going on there. And what we see in chapter 2 in the last few verses is that Jesus has begun his ministry. You know, he's no longer working as a carpenter, no longer taking care of Mary and his brothers and sisters. He's begun his ministry. He's performing miracles. He's teaching crowds. Everywhere he goes, people are flocking to him, wanting to know more about this man from Nazareth of Galilee. And part of that ministry is described at the tail end of chapter 2, when it says, "Now, when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover during the feast, many believed in his name." Isn't that great? Fantastic. Jesus is having an impact. Many people are believing in his name. But don't stop reading there. Continue on. Because it says they believed in his name, observing his signs which he was doing. They were believing as they saw the miracles that Jesus was performing. Anything wrong with that? Well, let's keep reading. But Jesus, on his part, was not entrusting himself to them, for he knew all men, and because he did not need anyone to testify concerning man, for he himself knew what was in man. And what's the point that's being described here? The point that's being described here is that this is a kind of belief that is not saving belief. This is the kind of belief that looked at Jesus in terms of what he did and listened to what he said and saw the kindness and the compassion and all the things that you could see as he moved among the people. And they saw all those things, and yet in spite of all those things, they didn't see him for who he really is and for the way they needed to respond to him. They loved the miracles. They loved the healing. They loved the success that they saw that he would bring to them. They loved the solving of life's problems. They loved the miracles, but they really didn't love the message. They weren't hearing the message that Jesus was preaching about why he came and what he came to do. And so the scripture says here that Jesus, knowing men, knowing the lostness, the darkness of our hearts, did not entrust himself to them, but moved on in his ministry. Does that sound a little bit like some of the popular theology today, by the way? People come to Jesus. Why? Because I have a need that I want Jesus to intervene and meet supernaturally. I have a family problem. I have a success problem. I have a financial shortfall. I have a rebellious kid. And we want to come to Jesus to solve those problems without realizing that the biggest message that we need to be proclaiming is Jesus came because we need a Savior. The worst problem of our lives is not the circumstances of our lives here, but the fact that we have sinned against a holy God, and that unless something is done about our sin problem, then we'll never make it to heaven. And that's what we need more than anything else, is we need Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior. We need faith in Him. We need to put our trust in Him. And then, having come to know Him, we'll entrust Him with whatever He chooses to do with other things. But our need is for a relationship with Almighty God. Well, that brings us then to chapter 3, where we're going to meet Nicodemus. And the first key word that you're going to see at the beginning of chapter 3 is the very first word, if you have a New American Standard translation, now. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus. That little bitty word, and sometimes little bitty words make a big difference in our understanding, the context, or maybe the whole of the teaching of a given passage. And that little word is a word that means now in contrast to what you have just read. Now, as opposed to the kinds of people that you have just seen, here is a man who is different. His name is Nicodemus. There's a contrast that is intended here. They all simply wanted the good life. Well, Nicodemus already had the good life, but he didn't have the thing that he needed most of all. Let me just give you some quick descriptions here of the way I would outline some understanding of who this Nicodemus was and what kind of person he was. The first thing that I would describe him as is being a learned man, a learned man. We don't use that word much anymore, do we? We don't say somebody is learned. We say they're erudite. Well, that didn't help any either, did it? We'd say he's smart. He knew the scriptures. He was a scholar, and he was committed to the study of God's word. He was committed to knowing it and living it as at least it had been taught to him and teaching it to others. How do I know all of that? Because he's described, first of all, as a Pharisee, as a Pharisee. Now, if we were to take all the time we need to go back and study everything that we maybe want to know about the Pharisees, we would find that their origin was way back in the Old Testament period, centuries earlier, right after Israel had gone through the Babylonian captivity. They had ceased to exist as a nation because of their sins, and yet at the same time, when God was allowing people to come back to the land in anticipation that one day there would be a nation there again, there were people who said, in light of their sufferings, in light of what they had lost, we don't ever want to see that happen again. You can read about some of those kinds of people in books like Ezra and Nehemiah, where there were still some people who wanted to turn towards God and follow His ways. And the most extreme of those peoples were the people who eventually became the Pharisees. Pharisee is basically a transliteration of a Hebrew word, parashim. And it means separate. It means distinct from. It means people who were going one direction and now have decided, don't want to go that direction anymore. We're going to go this direction. Our rebellion against God, our sins against God brought that. We want to go in a new way that brings blessing, and we want to bring honor to God in the way that we live. And so, he's a Pharisee. He's a Pharisee. I know we hear all the bad things about Pharisees and so forth. They're hypocritical, they're legalistic, blah, blah, blah. And most of them probably were in the first century period. But not all of them were. Some of them were really seeking. Nicodemus is a seeker. He wants to know the truth in light of what he has seen in the person and the ministry of Jesus. Second thing I would just note about him is he's a leader, because it says he was a man of the Pharisees and he was a ruler of the Jews. And that Greek word translated ruler there, archon, would indicate that he was part of the Jewish Supreme Court called the Sanhedrin. Maybe you've heard that word before. 71 men who ruled over the religious affairs of Israel. Politically, Israel is underneath the authority of Rome. But Rome allowed many peoples, like the Jews, to rule over their own religious affairs, as long as they didn't contradict anything that Rome deemed would be something they would want people to experience. And so he's part of the group of people who are called the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin. They were kind of like a Congress and Supreme Court all rolled into one, because they were responsible for the teaching of God's word, for the passing on of God's principles to the people at large. And at the same time, whenever there were possible violations of God's law, or if there was need for greater understanding of how to apply God's law to their current circumstances, they would step in as legalists who could handle those questions. And already in this period of time that we read about here, they had begun to write down all the different ways the law should be interpreted. You know, how many ways can you honor your father and your mother? Well, they had dozens of ways they had decided, and they had written them all down. And if you wanted to be a real devout person who honored God, you know, you would learn all of those ways that they had written down. Third and most importantly about Nicodemus, though, this comes from looking at the conversation that he's about to have with Jesus, is that he's a lost man. He's a lost man. Obviously, he doesn't have what Jesus has, which is what brought him there that night. You have something I don't have. I have been doing this business for who knows how long, maybe decades. In verse 10, he is called the teacher in Israel. And that little article there, the, means the preeminent teacher, the most honored teacher, the man that you would listen to when it came to opinions about what God's word meant and what God's word said. He was the teacher. But at the same time, when he looks at Jesus, he sees something that he does not have. And that was a personal relationship with this one that he would meet with that night. So what did he want? What did he want? Why did he come to Jesus? And let me read, and then let me just offer some details here, some comments. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you have come from God as a teacher, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." First question that everybody likes to talk about is, why did he come at night? Why did he come at night? And if you care to peruse the commentaries, you'll get a whole list of reasons suggested as to why he came at night. Won't go through the whole list with you of things that I have read, but there seem to be a couple of reasons that I think probably ring true to me, I think, more than any others. I think one reason he came at night is because he wanted time alone with Jesus. Alone with Jesus. That was impossible in the daytime, because every place Jesus went, crowds would gather. You know, people were always around him. And if you had a personal thing you wanted to ask the Lord, unless you wanted 20 or 30 or 50 more people to listen in and hear what was said, well, you better not ask that question. He wanted time alone because he's got a serious question he wants to ask the Lord. And that, coupled with another thing, I think would be his reputation. His reputation. He has long been the preeminent teacher in Israel. He's the man that everybody listens to. And what would people think if they saw the preeminent teacher going to some upstart teacher like Jesus and seeking counsel or seeking advice from him? His reputation may well have been on task here. What is important is what he came to ask. And he begins by addressing Jesus as Rabbi. That's Hebrew transliterated over into English, which means literally "my great one." But it's obviously a term that was given only to people who were wise enough in the scriptures and who lived the kind of exemplary life that they felt the scriptures taught. That term was reserved for them. And more particularly for somebody like the Pharisees, it would be somebody who's gone through their rigorous training to know what the scriptures mean so they could teach it to others. So he addresses him as a rabbi, and he makes this statement, "We know that you have come from God as a teacher." How could anybody miss the miracles? How could anybody not see the crowds? How could not anyone see that Jesus was having an impact on people? But he says, no one can do these signs. That's John's word for miracles. So miracles now are already a part of Jesus' ministry. No one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. And there's his question. Now, some of you might say, I wasn't an English major, and I wasn't really good in English in high school, but I don't see a question mark there. Where's the question? Well, the question is in behind the words and what's being asked. This is what I see you doing. This is what I see about your relationship with God. This is what I see in you. Why not me? Why do not I experience the same thing? Why is my ministry devoid of these things that characterize you? And then as a secondary question, how can I have what you have so I can take that back into the ministry that I do? Kind of reminds us here that the thing that grabs people's attentions about any of us or anything in our society is something that works. Isn't that right? If we see something that works, you know, that grabs our attention more than just something that somebody throws out and says, you ought to try this because I think it'll work. We do things that we know that work, that somebody can show that they have done it and it came out well for them. Just thinking about many years ago, we lived in Florida, and one evening there was announced that there was going to be this financial guru who was going to be at a local hotel, and he's going to tell us how to get rich quick. And pastors don't want to get rich, but I went. So, and I went down there by myself to this hotel, not knowing what I was going to see or to experience. Because when I got close to the hotel, what I found is the freeway was packed with cars. And when I finally could get off the freeway, I thought, well, there's an accident somewhere. No, everybody was going to this conference, this one-night conference. And they were parking in the parking lot, and they were parking on the grass, and there were policemen with batons out there and everything. And when I got into the hotel, it was standing room only. Everybody wanted to know what this guru had to say about how to get rich. And so I listened and went home just as poor as I was before. But he had a plan that worked, apparently, for some people. A plan that I wasn't willing to be a part of, but a plan that worked, apparently, grabs people's attention. Why was Nicodemus concerned about Jesus? Because of what he saw. Because of what Jesus did. Jesus was accomplishing things that neither he nor any of his brothers could. There was something about Jesus that was different. Jesus was different, and he wanted to know what. Well, this is where we get then to the conversation, and what did Jesus have to say to this man? And one of the things that we need to note at the outset and what's going to follow is, like in any good Bible study, if you go through a passage of Scripture and you see words that get repeated, you know, that's shouting out to you, this is important, if the same word keeps getting used over and over again. And one of the words that's a key word that you need to note throughout this passage and what Jesus said is the word born, B-O-R-N. 8 times Jesus is going to say, born. You must be born. You must be born. 8 times. That stands out as a key word. And not as many times, but nevertheless, alongside it is the word that's translated again. Again, born again. See that in verse 3, and you'll see it again in verse 8. Jesus' message is you must be born again. The word again is a word that, by the way, kind of needs to be understood in another sense, because the word could have been, and maybe should have been, translated from above. From above. Being born again and being born from above. Need to hold those concepts together, because that's the heart of what Jesus is going to tell this man about having a relationship with God and what was the secret with his ministry and his power. Let me tell you three things that Jesus says about being born again, being born in the way that he talks about it here, and this second birth that he says that Nicodemus needs and that every person needs if they want to have a relationship with God. The first thing that we should note about it is it's a birth that alters the course of our lives. It's a birth that alters the course of our lives. We live in a day and time in which a lot of the debate that goes on in churches today, ironically, is about how does a person get right with God? How does a person get saved? How does a person get to heaven? How do we have God in our lives? And if you wanted to put all the views on a spectrum, because you could do this, you'll see that it goes from one extreme to the other. One extreme is just to say, well, you just trust in Christ and basically nothing else happens. You trust in Christ and nothing really changes about you. You're still the same as you were before, but now you just added a motto or another statement that now fits in with your description of who you are. Now, on the other extreme are those people who say, well, there's this trusting of Christ, but now it's really going to be evident because of the extremes to which you're willing to go in the way that you live, because it's going to really shake things up in your life. Well, I think the scriptures teach we're closer to being right if we're on that end. Jesus didn't come to save people just to populate heaven. He came to save us and then leave us here so that he could change the course of our lives, the kind of people that we are, the kinds of behaviors that we exhibit, the kinds of ways that we talk, the kinds of priorities that now will be found in our lives. But salvation is intended to be a life-altering kind of experience for us. Nicodemus, verse 4, had said to him, Jesus said to him in verse 3, I say to you, unless one is born again, born from above, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Cannot see the kingdom of God. You know, what's interesting at this point is to kind of take a survey of all the different ways the Bible talks about entering into a relationship with God. And when I was in seminary, you take a whole course in this because there are so many terms, and each term provides a different perspective on salvation. And even after you've looked at all these terms, you still come walking away with saying, boy, this is a wonderful thing that God has done for me. For example, one of the common terms is redemption. Redemption. That comes from the slave market, from a person who is a slave, but then someday somebody comes along and sets them free, pays the price and sets them free. We're redeemed. We're set free from the penalty and the power of sin. Another one is reconciliation. Reconciliation describes two parties who were apart, but they're brought together because of someone who brings them together. That's a concept that's found. Another one is adoption. Before we came to Christ, we were not part of God's family. We were out there somewhere. But when we trust Christ, now he brings us into the family as sons and daughters. Sons and daughters. Imagine that. And now this one, new birth. Each one of these adds a different element to how we understand salvation. What does new birth add? Well, think about the birth of a baby. What happens in the birth of a baby? There is an altering of the course of their life. There's an altering of the way they were before into the way now they're going to become. Before, when they're still within their mother, they're in that sac with amniotic fluid, and you know, they grow and they grow and they grow, and then the day comes when the sac ruptures and the baby is born, and now they are exposed to a brand new world out here where everything is different. Everything has changed. That's what the idea of new birth, I think, brings here more than anything else. The idea that this is what we were, but now the course of our life has changed because we have entered into this relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, Nicodemus doesn't get this. Look at verse 4. Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he's old? He cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born, can he?" And people have bashed Nicodemus at this point, and they said, "I thought you told me this guy was a smart guy, and did he fail biology or something? What is this deal here? He's talking about going back into the mother and being born again, and he's smarter than that." This is just figurative language in which he's just saying to Jesus, "I don't get it. I really don't know what you're saying. Can you explain further? Can you help me to understand? Because I don't get it. I don't get it." New birth, first of all, points us then in a new direction. It alters the course of our lives. The second thing then that Jesus told him about this new birth is that it is accomplished by the Holy Spirit, not us. And this is where the change that Nicodemus needed to recognize more than anything else occurs. It's accomplished by the Holy Spirit, not by us. Look at verses 5 through 8. Jesus answered and said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. Do not be amazed that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but do not know where it comes from and where it is going. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit." The emphasis is upon what? The activity of the Holy Spirit in causing the new birth. The activity of the Holy Spirit in convicting us of our sins so that we know that we need the new birth. The activity of the Holy Spirit giving us the ability to recognize that this is truth. Truth that we need to respond to. The activity of the Holy Spirit that says there's only one way out from where you are, and that's by your faith in Jesus Christ. Let me take a side trip here just for a moment, because there's been much debate over verse 5 and what Jesus is talking about. And Jesus said, "I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." And I think, unfortunately, sometimes we get hung up on one verse to the point that we miss the bigger picture of what's being described. And the big question people ask is, what does he mean by being born of water and being born of the Spirit? Well, a few minutes ago, I told you about the commentaries, you know, and they list all these different views and so forth. And you'll find the same thing here, even more so when people try to describe, what did he mean by being born of water and being born of the Spirit? Most common view, I suppose, is that water refers to baptism. You have to be baptized to be saved. And I would say I don't subscribe to that for a number of reasons. One reason is because as you look through this gospel, which is written solely for the purpose of telling people how to be saved, that's what he said in John chapter 20 and verses 30 and 31, that the signs which I have recorded for you is so that you may know that Jesus is the Son of God, and that by believing in his name, you may have eternal life. Someone has counted, I never did the count myself, but has counted that 98 times in this gospel, belief is what is said to be the way that a person enters into a relationship with God. And baptism is not specifically mentioned, not one time. Well, what do you mean then by this water reference here if he's not referring to baptism? Well, I think we have to go back and say, well, what would John have, or what would Nicodemus have understood as a teacher? What would people in that day and time have understood? Because the church hasn't been born yet, so, how can he'd be referring to being baptized. What would Nicodemus have understood? Well, I think what Nicodemus would have understood is that Old Testament concept, which is found in Ezekiel 36, among other places. Ezekiel chapter 36, God said to Ezekiel, while Israel's in bondage and in their captivity, that one day he was going to deliver them from that captivity, and this is how he described it. "I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols. Moreover, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you, and I'll remove the heart of your flesh and give you a heart, a new heart. And I'll put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you'll be careful to observe my ordinances." It's just one reference, but that's something that was a concept in Jewish thinking and is found in the Old Testament, that there was a washing that takes place, a cleansing that takes place supernaturally when we come to God, but not a literal stepping into water, but just a figurative reference to the cleansing that God's Spirit brings when He works in our lives and causes then the application of Jesus' blood to the forgiveness of our sins. The washing then of the water then is a figurative reference then, I believe, to those Old Testament passages like that one. And then the mention of the Holy Spirit as the one who achieves, who brings about this this new birth. Then there's a third thing I would have you to note out of this passage of Scripture. It alters the course of our lives. It's accomplished by the Spirit. The most exciting news of all, it's available to all who believe. It is available to all who believe. Nicodemus said to him, verse 9, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Are you the teacher of Israel and do not understand these things? Truly I say to you, we speak of what we know and testify of what we have seen. You do not accept our testimony. Jesus' teaching on this has been rejected so far. If I told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things?" And then he begins to tell him the authority upon which he brings these truths to Nicodemus. "No one has ascended into heaven but he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man." You're looking at him. You're looking at him. You're looking at him. And then he offers this Old Testament picture that would be so familiar to Nicodemus. "As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that whoever believes will in him have eternal life." What's he referring to? Well, he's referring to that time back in Numbers 21, if you want to go back and read the story. Israel's in the wilderness. They're on their way to the promised land. But 40 years was wearing heavy on them, and from time to time, they would approach Moses and they'd say, "Did you bring us out here to die? We had it much better when we were in Egypt. Why do we have to keep suffering like this?" And God would have to chastise them to get their eyes back on the fact that he was taking them to a promised land and to remind them why they weren't there already. And in that particular instance, God sent fiery serpents, the scripture says, among the people. Described as fiery serpents because they were poisonous. And when they bit people, people would get deathly ill, and many did die, the scripture says. And as that began to happen, and as death is spreading throughout the camp, the people began to say to Moses, "Intercede for us with God. We're sorry. We're repentful. Tell him, Moses, in our behalf, that we want to turn back to him." And God gave this really unusual response for how he would deliver them. He told Moses to make a bronze snake and put it on a pole and stick it up in the ground. And he said, "Tell people, if you'll look at that bronze serpent, if you'll just look at that and believe that this is my answer for you, I will deliver you." And he did. And he did, supernaturally. People looked at just that symbol that God had stuck in the ground, and people then were healed from those fiery serpents. Nicodemus didn't get all of this, I'm sure. In fact, there are scholars who believe that the part we're in right now wasn't really spoken to Nicodemus, that it was maybe spoken to John's audience, us. But we can see that there was someone who's going to be stuck on a pole, who's going to be impaled on a piece of wood, and looking to him is the way to eternal life, and only to him. Which is how John winds this up in verse 16 when he says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." How much easier could God have made it for us, huh? Much easier. No effort on our part. No good thing that we have to do, no standard that we have to measure up to, just looking to the one who's on the cross. and putting our trust and our faith there. And for that, we get in exchange eternal life, forgiveness of sins. Have you come to know the Savior? Are you trusting in Him alone? Or are you trusting, as Nicodemus was that day, in something else that maybe He could do? There is nothing else we can do. God has taken care of the whole thing. He's done it through His Son, Jesus Christ. Today, if you haven't trusted Him, you can. You can put your faith and trust in Him. And where you sit, as you are, you receive that forgiveness of sins. You receive that gift of eternal life. As I mentioned to you earlier, eventually that happened with Nicodemus. Whether it happened that night or not, we'll never know until we get to heaven. But we know later that he is standing on the side of Jesus because he's trusted him as his personal Lord and Savior. Is that you? Are you trusting in Christ alone? Father, I thank you this morning for letting us have a look at the original Nick at Night, that conversation and confrontation between theologies here, and how you erased the thought that we could do something in order to be made right with you, and how instead you've caused us to realize that an answer has already been given in the person of Jesus. I thank you that through the person of your Holy Spirit, you bring this truth to us so that we can understand it and so that we can grasp it and we can trust in it. I pray today for the person who needs to do that. And for those of us who have, help us to realize this is the message now we have to share. Lead us, Lord, to see those divine opportunities that you have provided for us to share this good news so that others can come to grasp what you have allowed us to grasp. We thank you and we praise you for it now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Blessed be your name, the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, when found in the desert place, nor walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, a road marked with suffering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Indeed, blessed be the name of the Lord. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for the time together today. Thank you for the songs. Thank you for the text of Scripture we've looked at. Thank you for the message of Jesus. Thank you for the message of Jesus, our only hope. We pray now that as we leave the place today that you'll just give us a continued reflection upon how great the message of salvation is. And help us, O Lord, I pray, to examine our own hearts, to make sure that's what we're trusting in. But I pray for your grace and your love, your peace, and your direction rests upon every person and every family here today. This week, you know what lies ahead of us, so we pray in those moments that we'll be returned to the strength and the resources and all that only you can supply. And so we'll praise you and we'll thank you in advance for your doing that. In Jesus' name, amen.